All right, good morning, everyone. It is 10:05, so we're gonna go ahead and get started with our workshop today. Thank you all so much for being here virtually. A little different than we normally like to have it, but hey, we're adapting, right? This presentation will be recorded today, so you will be able to reference back to this, or if you have to step away at a certain time for kids or pets or whatever it may be, you'll be able to reference this in the future. Let's see here. Let me get my things together here. All right, so we are using Zoom today. So if you are new to Zoom, I'm gonna go over a couple of our Zoom functions that you're gonna use today. So if you have questions throughout this whole presentation, I encourage you to use the Q&A function, which you'll see on the screen here. I imagine you guys are seeing my screen. Hopefully this is all working right. But that little Q&A box may be somewhere within your screen, but you click on that and you can put your questions in there as they come up. I can either answer some of those typing as we're going along, or we'll stop Lad and ask him those questions as they come up. There's also the chat function. So as if you click on that, you can see I've already thrown a couple chats in there. I'll be using this today to throw some links in there for some resources and videos and things like that. So you'll want to have that open. This is also a good space to throw some dialogue in. That's not a question, just to say, oh, good point, or we might be asking you some questions throughout this, and that's how you can participate there in the chat. We also have the raised hand feature. So if you have a question that's just too long to type out, too complicated, you can actually raise your hand and I will see that. And then I can actually unmute you and you can talk to us. So those are the Zoom functions for the day. And I just want to thank you all for being here to talk about natural yard care. You know, our yards can really be a beautiful space for us to relax and enjoy our friends and families and pets. This is my yard here that used to just be all grass. And, you know, a benefit of this whole stay at home thing is that I think a lot of us have gotten to spend a lot more time in our yards. Not all of us, I know. But for me, that's been the case. And I've utilized a bunch of these natural yard care techniques to implement some cool stuff throughout my yard that keeps me busy, and I really enjoy it. So you can just kind of go off with this and do whatever you want and have fun in your yard. So, you know, our yards can be great places to hang out, but at the same time, they can actually cause a lot of damage to our environment and our surface waters if we're not following good natural yard care practices. And you know, as an environmentalist and someone who deals with surface water runoff, when you're looking at large residential areas, you do get a lot of nutrient runoff from just our front yards that we're trying to make pretty. So this leads to my first trivia question of the day. So open up your chat box and I wanna hear, what do you all think is our leading cause of pollution here in the Puget Sound? Type in your guesses. Don't be shy. Pesticides, commercial fishing. Any other guesses out there? Fertilizer and road grime. These are all really good. So it's kind of a trick question. It's kind of all those things you just mentioned. So stormwater, and stormwater is our leading cause of pollution here in the Puget Sound, and that's pretty much the case nationwide. So what stormwater is rain and snow that isn't allowed to soak down into the ground how it naturally would in a forest, right? When it rains in the forest, that water slowly soaks into the ground, gets taken up by trees and plants, and then makes it down to the groundwater. Here in urban areas, that water falls on hard surfaces like roads, rooftops, driveways, sidewalks, and as it runs along the pavement, these hard surfaces, it's considered stormwater. And along the way, as it's running across these hard surfaces, it's picking up heavy metals, petroleum products, pet waste. And then what we're talking about today is picking up a lot of those fertilizers and pesticides and herbicides and all that extra junk we're putting in our yards that we really don't need to have that beautiful yard that we're trying to achieve. A lot of that runs off of our properties, goes into storm drains, which lead right to our nearest lake, river, or stream, doing a lot of damage to our environment. So Lad's going to teach us how to help minimize this stormwater pollution. So thanks for the guesses. Before I turn it over to Lad, I want to give a plug for some of our other programs at the city that you should definitely be taking advantage of. So we have this natural yard care program, and I'll be dropping some links in the chat here soon where you can visit our natural yard care webpage, and we have all sorts of resources. Lad's going to bring a bunch of them up today that we usually hand out in person, but now you can go visit our website and download these. There's a ton of good resources on composting and soil health and natural yard care and composting and just a ton of good stuff. So I'll definitely drop that in. You'll want to check out our website. We also have a really great tree voucher program where if you live within the city of Lynnwood, city limits, you can get up to $500 per year for trees on your property. So I'll drop a link in the chat for you to check that out. So definitely take advantage of that. We also have a fish hatchery that we run on Hall Lake, where we raise 30,000 coho salmon each year and release them into Hall Lake. If you're interested in checking it out, we are offering private tours. We're just keeping groups pretty small for COVID reasons and all that, but it's a great activity for kids to learn about salmon and water quality, and they actually get to release some salmon into the lake at the end of the trip. So that's pretty cool. And then we also have an Earth Day event coming up on the 24th, where, the rain barrels are all sold out now, but maybe some of you on the call pre-ordered some rain barrels and got those, but there'll also be a free compost pile where you can come by and shovel up some compost. And then we're also gonna have a free shredding event. So if you have any sensitive documents that need to be shredded, you can bring it by and get those shredded. And that's on April 24th from 10 to 2. And I'll drop the link in the chat for more details there. My name is Cameron Coronado. I'm with the city of Lynnwood on their, within their public works division in their environmental and surface water division. And I'm a surface water technician. And I do a lot of education and outreach like this. So I'll be facilitating today, monitoring the back end of Zoom and taking care of any of those technical issues. There's my contact info if you wanna contact me with any questions or follow-up from this event. And last but not least, I'm gonna present or give a little intro for our great presenter today. We're so lucky to have Lad with us today. He co-founded In Harmony Sustainable Landscapes in 1994 with his business partner, Mike Guile, out of his lifelong passion for protecting the environment. In Harmony Sustainable Landscapes is a provider of organic-based landscape services in Kings, Snohomish, and Pierce County. He earned his BS degree in ornamental horticulture from the University of Nevada, Reno. In Harmony has received numerous awards, including the prestigious Washington State Governor's Award for Pollution Prevention, the Northwest Environmental Guide's Environmental Achiever of the Year Award, and the Washington State Nursery Landscape Association 2007 Environmental Excellent Award. In Harmony is a King County 5-star EnviroStar. In Harmony has been featured in a lot of different publications like Sunset Magazine, Northwest Home and Garden, and the American Garden Magazine. And Lad is a super sought after speaker on various organic landscaping topics. He's been a regular presenter for the King and Snohomish County's highly successful natural yard care programs for almost 15 years. We've had Lad come to Lynnwood a few times now to speak. So we are just super happy to have him today, even if it's virtually. So with that, I am going to stop my screen share and turn it over to the one and only Lad Smith.
Thank you, Cameron, very, very much. Nice intro. I don't know if I can uphold all those nice things you said about me. So we might as well just get started, I guess. But good morning, everybody. I really appreciate it. As Cameron said, I really appreciate you joining us this morning. And I hope I'm going to give you some really nice information about how to take care of your lawns. in a natural way. Okay. So, because that's one thing is like Cameron had just mentioned is that for our wanting to always achieve like the perfect lawn, a lot of times in our urban environments, we're using a lot of resources. We're using, you know, sometimes we misuse products like water. We have a huge impact on our solid waste systems, like down here with all the clippings and everything that we push off into our solid waste systems. And a lot of the products that we use end up in these storm drains and directly influence the environment around us. So what I'm hoping to talk to you about today is methods that, and a lot of them that we already do, but methods that we can change to really make our lawns as healthy and as thick and vigorous as we can, which in turn becomes our best weed control and our best moss control is really having our lawn as healthy as possible. So that's what I'll be talking to you about today. And really, you know, there's different thoughts on lawn care, right? I mean, you have some people that are very intense on how they take care of their lawn and how they want it to look. And there's some people that want it, you know, completely natural, not doing anything. And really what we're looking for with a natural lawn is something that's environmentally sensitive, but it's safe for our families, safe for our pets, safe for the wildlife that might come through there. It's nice and lush like this one, this lawn that we help take care of. And if it's fed well, and if it's mowed correctly, and if it's given the water that it needs, most lawns can be really nice without having to use a lot of products that that are sold at the garden centers in order to combat some of the problems that we think we have on our lawns. So, and moss is one thing I'll talk about here a little bit later. And a lot of people, moss is a big challenge in their yards. And if they have a lot of moss, I usually tell people that it's not a lawn problem, but it's not a moss problem. It's a lawn problem. There's a challenge with the lawn not being as healthy and vigorous as we want it. And then because of that, the moss can become a really tough competitor. So we need to focus in on the lawn to make sure that it's doing its job, and that will help take care of the moss instead of just going, oh, I got moss and now I need to kill everything to get rid of the moss. So I'll talk about that a little bit later with the moss and stuff like that. But a lot of this is just making our lawns as healthy as possible so that they can be everything that we want them to be in our yards and stuff. So what I'm going to teach you today is everything you need to know for a great lawn. I'll talk a little bit about healthy soils because it's a huge key for any gardening practice. I don't care if you're growing vegetables or if you're growing perennials or shrubs or your lawn, healthy soils are a key. Then I'll talk to you about the 6 steps of natural lawn care, which if we're doing it correctly, you're going to have a nice lawn. But sometimes if we're doing all the things we think are right and it's not working out, it might just be that it's the wrong plant in the wrong place and we need to rethink those lawn areas. And I'll go over that a little bit too, because lawn doesn't grow great everywhere in the Pacific Northwest. And then we'll just kind of talk about some renovations about how to take care of that for you. And maybe just kind of throw off, Cameron had talked about too, but you know, all the steps are kind of based on the natural yard care program, and he'll send you a link for that. And the steps for natural yard care is building healthy soils, right plant, right place, using water correctly, thinking twice before using pesticides. And then the 5th step is natural lawn care. So under the natural yard care umbrella is natural lawn care. And those steps are in the back of the natural yard care pamphlet. And then there's even a better pamphlet for the natural yard care that natural lawn care that you'll get that will go over all the steps that I'm talking about, plus even more links and information and stuff like that. So tremendous amount of information so that you can continue with the steps that I'm talking to you about today. And one of the pamphlets that they also have links there is building healthy soil again, which is the 1st step of natural yard care. And really is what we need to do to make sure that we have healthy lawns is to make sure that we're taking care of our soils. And like this slide shows right here, really the key for healthy soils is organic matter, rich organic matter. And compost is a huge part of that. And it makes a tremendous difference in how our plants react to the soil that they're growing in. And a lot of us have to deal with urban soils, you know, because they might've come in and taken out all the good soils in order to develop homes and sidewalks and everything else, but they don't bring in good soils back in order to grow our plants. They might bring in a little bit of topsoil and then start growing plants. And a lot of times our plants struggle because of that. So if we can, from the very beginning, incorporate compost into those hard pan urban soils, tremendous difference. And that's what these trials were showing at the University of Washington, is that here, this upper lawn, they grew just on our urban glacier till that we have a lot of times. And you can see after a short period of time, it's already yellowing out. It's already kind of getting some weeds coming in there and mosses moving in. It just doesn't look well. And the only difference between this lawn and the lawn down here on the bottom is that they were able to incorporate compost. And that means amending, that means mixing it with the soil before they planted. And look how much different this lawn looks. I mean, it's green, it's thick, it's lush. And the only difference is that they were able to add compost beforehand. So a lot of times it's not possible for most people to add compost, or like if you already have an existing yard and you're going, oh my gosh, I'm gonna have to rip everything out in order to make that work. I'll talk to you a little bit later about how to add compost to your existing soils with aeration top dressing, where you can get the same results by incorporating compost into your soil profile without having to rip up all your plants. But this is what we're looking for, is we're looking for a lawn that's thick and lush and vigorous growing. So that becomes our number one weed control and our number one moss control by having a lawn like this. And the reason they did these trials is they wanted to show the difference of these different kind of lawns on surface water runoff, just like Cameron was talking about. So these were actually grown where there was a grade from the top going down to the bottom. You can see down on the bottom, this is where they collected the water. And they found by just having a nicer lawn that they reduced stormwater runoff by 50%. So half of the stormwater runoff is eliminated by just having a nicer lawn. And so that's the beauty of what these things I'll be talking about today, just natural yard care in itself, is that just by doing these practices, not only are you going to have a better yard, but you're reducing the amount of water that comes off of our landscapes and our homes and our little urban environments, and that's impacting our environment around us. So it's twofold win-win situation, better lawn and reduction of water movement, because when you have a lawn like this, it allows that water to slow down, allows that water to spread out, and it allows that water to sink into the existing soils like it does in a forest, just like Cameron had mentioned. So that's what we're trying to recreate with these natural yard care practices, is the ability for water to just kind of slow itself down through our landscapes, spread itself out, slowly move into our existing soils, and then eventually get down to the groundwater where we don't have an impact on our urban environment by stormwater runoff, okay? So all plants grow well, but especially lawn grows well on healthy soils. So everything that I'll be talking to you about today really is impacting the soils as much as we're impacting the lawn, because that's what we want to do, continue to build healthy soils in our landscapes by just doing these practices, okay? So here's the six steps of natural lawn care that we're going to be going through. Most of these, like I said, are probably things that most people are already doing in their yard. We're just going to switch it up a little bit. The first one's about mowing. The second one is about fertilizing or feeding our lawns. The third one is about water. Fourth one is a cultural practice, aerations, which anybody who's in the turf business, like and works in a golf course, they all aerate all the time at these places. So aerification is a huge key for a natural lawn to be as healthy as possible. With this practice, we can also throw down some seed to help the lawn thicken up. And then to get maximum results, I'll talk about top dressing with compost or directly inject compost down into your existing soil to get those results. The fifth step is thinking twice before using any pesticides. And just to kind of, so we're on the same page, when we're talking about pesticides, aside, the root word aside means to kill, right? So when we're talking about like a homicide division in a police force, that's people who are going around looking for people who kill people, because a homicide is killing of another person. When we talk about genocide, we talk about killing of a lot of people. So aside means to kill. Pesticide, just like I said, it means to kill pests. But in horticulture, we have insecticides that kill insects. We have fungicides that kill funguses. We have herbicides that kill plants. We have molluscicides that kill slugs and snails. We have mammaliacides that kill little furry creatures. We have all these different killers that are under the umbrella of a pesticide, okay, to kill a pest. So there's a lot available in in horticulture to be able to kill things out there, kill insects, kill funguses, kill little furry creatures, kill slugs and snails, kill plants. So all of these are need to be thought of in a mindful manner if they're ever going to be used, okay? So we always think twice before using any of those products. And really, if you're doing all the things that are above this with the natural lawn care, your lawn's going to be really nice, and pesticides really then become not a decision-making process. It just becomes, you just don't want to use them, okay? And then again, if there's all these things are going on, you're solving problems, maybe we just need to rethink that lawn area because it just might be the wrong plant in the wrong place, okay? So let's get going with the steps of natural yard care or natural lawn care. I was actually driving through Bellevue one day and I saw this written on someone's garage door, mow, you know, like as in giving chores, the chore list on the garage so that, you know, it would be front and center when someone got home. So sometimes mowing can be a big challenge for people because they just want to get it over. But what we're trying to do with the mowing part of the natural lawn care is teach you ways to really have a better lawn because we're doing our mowing. So we're just going to switch it up a little bit. But the number one thing that anybody can do for their lawn is to sharpen with a sharp blade. That means to mow with a sharp blade. I got one down here, like, and you know, it's probably better when we're in person and stuff, but with a sharp blade, we're not talking razor sharp. It has an edge on it though. It has an edge where it cuts the lawn instead of beating the lawn, okay? I have another one here. You probably can't see very well. I wish it was coming a little bit better. But even after 1 year of mowing, this blade has like little chunks out of it. And it's just dull. And it's just, it's not going to cut. It's going to beat the lawn, okay, instead of cutting. And a lot of lawnmowers get to that point over a short period of time where they're literally not cutting anymore. We're beating the lawn. And the lawn has a very difficult time recovering from that. When we use a sharp blade, and we're able to, because it's an injury to the plant, right? So when you're cutting it, it's an actual injury to the plant. We need that injury to be as sharp as possible in order for the plant to recover from that injury as quick as possible. But when we cut with a dull blade, what we're doing is actually beating the lawn then and not actually cutting it. And you get these frayed edges at the top of a lawn. And really, sometimes get on your hands and knees and look at your grass blades. And I will sometimes see lawns where it's so frayed that they have, it almost looks like a white film all over the top of the top of the grass. And the lawn just doesn't look as healthy as green as possible. And the reason is that all those tips that are frayed die off and leave like this little yellow, white, chalky tissue behind that just doesn't look good. So number one thing people can do is just get a sharp blade. You can take it to a regular lawn mowing, service. I mean, you know, like an equipment service that do lawnmower work, and they can put a cut on it for you, just sharpen it up. Or sometimes just putting a new blade on it costs like $30 is the quickest and easiest way to get this blade as sharp as possible to be able to give you a nice cut. But makes a big difference by just having a sharp blade. So that's the number one thing you can do: have a sharp blade when we're cutting, and sharpen it on a semi-regular basis. For so most lawns, it might just be twice a year. But for like some lawn mowing companies, they might have to put sharp blades on every couple of days because of how much they're mowing and stuff like that. So take a look at your blade, see what it's looking like, but sharpen it if need be in order to get your best cut. Okay. And then we also recommend, we need to grow our lawns in the Pacific Northwest a little taller. You know, 2.5-3 inches is really a nice height for grasses. A lot of times people want to cut it way too low because that's what like golf courses do on the greens and stuff like that. And really for golf courses, it's a tremendous amount of energy to keep the lawn happy, looking like it's happy when it's cut that short. For most of our regular home lawns and stuff like that, easiest thing to do is to cut about 2.5 to 3 inches and leave it at that length. And then it's becoming a really nice barrier for weeds and moss to have to compete with because it's more of a tenacious plant when it's grown that tall. And when you're cutting, we have what we call the 1/3 rule, right? You never cut more than 1/3 of the grass off every time you're cutting. So if you're going to cut down to 2.5 to 3 inches, you might let it grow up to like 3, maybe even 4 inches before you bring it back down. But if you let it go much more than that, and then you start cutting it down to try to remove much more than that, you can do some, you can set your lawn back and cause some damage. So main thing for spring and fall mowing is to be consistent with it and try to be on it as much as possible so you can just respond to this 1/3 rule and not cut up more than that because it's growing so much for you. And really, grass plants themselves are a unique plant on how they grow, where most plants, all the energy is at the tips, right? You see all the trees and shrubs growing right now. All the buds are swelling and all the new leaves are coming out on all the edges. And that's how plants grow. They just keep on getting larger and larger and larger as that growth comes from this tip growth and stuff. But for grass plants, all the growth comes from this area called the crown, which is right down here at the soil surface. So this crown is the transition period for the grass blades growing up, which is it, you know, its growing mechanism. And then roots down below, which we want the roots to be as deep and thick and luscious, I mean, as possible. And that's why we want to have the top half as having as much green growth as possible to be able to photosynthesize to feed these roots down below. But the crown is really what we need to make sure that we're taking care of with lawns. And so what they have found with studies is that if we cut too low and we don't leave enough of the grass blade to be green in order for the roots to be healthy, we can actually diminish the amount of roots that we have by cutting it too short. But when we leave the grass taller, we get more roots down below. And when a plant is happy, when a grass plant is happy, there's certain varieties and we call them bunch grasses. And when they're happy, they actually send out underneath rhizomes to thicken themselves up to get more grass plants. So in the Pacific Northwest, we can grow, if we mow our lawns a little bit taller, we'll actually have better grass plants, which respond by thickening themselves up by sending underground roots systems up. And that's what we're really going for. If the plant's grown too short or cut too short all the time, it doesn't have the energy or the willingness to try to thicken itself up. But you will naturally thicken up your lawn by just growing it taller, okay? So mowing too low means that, like, you can see a green lawn, and then once we get it mowed, it's kind of yellow because we have cut off all the grass blades on top, and now we're just down to the crown, which means the plant is in big trouble. That means the plant has to use energy from its root system in order to try to recover from this because we didn't leave any grass blades in order for the plant to photosynthesize. They've done studies again, and when we mow taller, we actually leave more grass blades to recover from this photosynthesizing, and it'll actually grow better. So a lot of people will mow low because they don't want to mow. And they just say, if I just whack it to the ground, then I don't have to mow as often. And that's really the wrong attitude to take. It should be, you know what? I'm going to mow a little more often, but keep it taller to keep the grass blades growing because the grass will respond positively because of that, and I want to grow more, which means we just need to be more on top of our mowing and just not let it get out of control. But if our method is to grind our plant, grass plants, to the ground by cutting to the crown of the plant and then making the plant use its reserves of its energy in order to recover from that, and we keep doing that to the plant, then pretty soon the grass starts dying off and you'll have nothing but moss and weeds. So again, number one, moss control. Number one, weed control in our lawns is having the lawn thick and lush enough that the plants that we don't want there are having a difficulty competing in that environment. Okay, so do not cut too low, cut taller on a regular basis. Okay, and as much as possible, use a mulching mower. And if you're going to replace your mowing blade, because you need a sharper blade, a lot of times you can just buy a mulching blade as a substitute for your regular a regular mowing blade. And I showed you a couple of different kinds of mulching mowers when I showed you these two blades. One like this one has a one cutting surface, and then it has another cutting surface on the other end. So when it cuts, it puts it into multiple chunks. The other one had two blades on it. So it's almost like a razor that we buy for our faces or our legs and stuff like that, where it has multiple blades, and that cuts off even more of the lawn. But what we want to do is, instead of having big chunks from one cut, it cuts it into smaller pieces like this, which you don't even see on your lawn when it's done correctly. And so with a good mulching blade, as it's passing through the grass, it's cutting it once and then cutting it two or three or four more times with these other multiple blades back here to leave smaller pieces of grass blade behind. And most grass blades are mostly water, okay? A little bit of tissue, mostly water. So when it's cut into these smaller pieces and it gets down on the grass and dehydrates, you won't even see it's there. But what it's doing is adding organic matter in little teeny bits and pieces. Every time we mow, which is building our soils, which is what we want to do. So leave your grass clippings down, just do it with a mulching blade so you don't even see them, and you'll be building your soil, which means that you have a healthier soil, plus these little bits and pieces of grass blade are green, which is nitrogen. And so when it breaks down in the soil, it replaces the nitrogen. So you have a constant supply of an organic source of nitrogen by just leaving your grass blades down. Okay, so really easy to do. And in the Pacific Northwest, we have what we call these surges of growth because how the plant's responding to our temperatures and moisture. So in spring, we have a huge, huge spring growth. And then it slows down once we get into summertime, right? All the lawns slow down, we see that. And then we'll have another smaller, but yet a pretty significant recovery time in fall where the grasses are recovering from that summer stress. They're bringing in nutrients into their roots, preparing for the winter, but they're also growing. And so we'll get another surge. So when we're mulch mowing and when we're doing natural lawn care, we need to use our mowing practices to kind of mimic the mowing, how the grass is growing, which means we might have to mow a little more often in springtime to stay on top of it. Maybe in summertime, it might get to be where you're mowing every couple of weeks, but then in fall time, it might ramp it back up. We might have to be mowing more often. And that's really what we need to do is mow according to how our lawns are growing, instead of just saying every Tuesday I'm mowing stuff because it might not need it. And it might get out of control in springtime when, especially if you're doing like every other week, you just might not be able to keep up with it. Okay. So mowing really for natural lawn care means mowing taller, mowing more regularly, and as much as possible, leaving those clippings down as mulch mowing, grass cycling. There's a lot of different names for it, but look at your mower. Like I said, you can sometimes just buy another blade, and they might give you a plug that you put in where the grass clippings come out, and you just plug up that spot, and it just cuts the grass blades more and more, and then puts it back down your lawn. You'll save yourself some time also because you're not having to remove those grass blades in your bag on when you're mowing. So a lot of positive things by mowing differently. And it's a very simple step, sharp blade and mow regularly and more higher. Okay. So fertilizing, and I mentioned just a minute ago, if you're going to mulch mow, you can actually reduce the amount of fertilizer you're putting out there because those grass blade clippings are adding organic nitrogen every time we mow. And for lawns, nitrogen is what the element is that makes lawns green. And so for most fertilizers, nitrogen is the first number. With all fertilizers, nitrogen that they give you, the big three, nitrogen is first, second one is phosphorus, third one is potassium. So it's NPK is how they label it on all fertilizers. And all fertilizers that are sold on a commercial basis give you a guaranteed analysis that in this bag, what everything they put in there, you'll at least have 5% nitrogen, 5% phosphorus, 5% potassium in this bag, okay? So this is like an all-purpose balanced fertilizer, which a lot of times we use for flowers and fruits and vegetables and stuff like that. For lawns, we want the nitrogen number to be a little bit larger, and we want that phosphorus number to be smaller, zero if possible. So look for lawn fertilizers, not just all-purpose fertilizers. Where you again, this middle number, phosphorus, we want it to be a zero or a one. We don't need as much phosphorus for lawns, but we do want that nitrogen. So most organic fertilizers you'll find will have an 8 or 10 for the nitrogen or below that. And then the phosphorus can be a zero or a one, okay? But that's really what we're looking for, a lawn fertilizer, not an all-purpose, but a lawn fertilizer. And you want to use an organic or natural one too, because those are the elements that the lawns and the soils recognize in order to break down, in order to feed the lawn with those natural elements of nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, and all the other micronutrients that come with it, okay? And it doesn't matter if you choose to use an organic or a synthetic fertilizer. There's a couple of things that everyone has to do in order to be just better about not having a lot of these nutrients being run off into our stormwater systems. Number one is that if you have any of these products that get on hardscapes, sidewalks, driveways, patios, whatever it is, you got to get that off of those hardscapes and get it onto the soil and onto the lawn so it can do what it's supposed to do in those environments. But if we just leave it on those hardscapes, the first rain washes it all off. And a lot of those nutrients causes us a lot of problems, especially even algae blooms because of the phosphorus in our water systems and stuff. So any spills, any overthrow has to be cleaned up, put back on the lawn. And always follow product guidelines. They will give you instructions on the product, how much to use, when to use it, and stuff like that. we recommended people use less, you know what I mean? And then if you don't get the response you want, now you can add a little bit more, but it's never good with any of these products to just overuse them because you just want to just get a bigger charge out of what's going on or something like that. So follow product guidelines, use a little bit less. If you don't get the results, you can add a little bit more, but never use more than what's recommended on the bags, okay? And fertilizer patterns. We see more problems with people not realizing what they're doing when they're putting down the product. First of all, there's two different kinds of spreaders that we use to apply fertilizers. One is a broadcast spreader. That means that the fertilizer falls through a hole in the spreader, hits a paddle that's usually spinning around, and that paddle gives us a throw of like, you know, 2, 3, 4 feet, whatever, depending on what the size of the spreader and the paddle and your speed is, right? So if you're going faster and that paddle's going faster, it might even throw it out further and stuff. So we have a broadcast spreader. We also have a drop spreader that people use. You put the fertilizer in the hopper, and then when you pull the handle, that hopper just drops that fertilizer straight down on the ground in that same width pattern of the hopper, okay? So there's no difference. It doesn't throw it out. It's just dropping it straight down. So this person thought they had a broadcast spreader, but they had a drop spreader. So what they did is they did a broadcast pattern, which is what you're doing with this, is that you're spreading it out, but yet they just applied fertilizer to the pattern of the drop spreader, right? So if you're going to use a drop spreader, you'd come back here and you'd actually just go over like one wheel pattern and go straight back up. One wheel pattern, come straight back down, one, you know, back and forth, back and forth. With a broadcast, you kind of do it this way, is that you give yourself space in between your patterns, but with the throw, you're getting an overthrow and an even pattern to your fertilizer. So know which kind of spreader you have and how it works. And again, just kind of dial it back a little bit so you're just not throwing it everywhere or not throwing it in the right places. So you can see it greened up because this part's got fertilizer, these parts didn't. It just it's just misuse of the product. So know what you got, okay? And as much as possible, my number one message with my natural lawn care talk is please no more weed and feed products. These are sold as an easy fix to our lawns. They're sold as don't worry about it, just put it down and your lawn greens up, which it does. And most of these weed control products, the weed and feeds, the nitrogen is probably a 20. Some I've even seen 30% nitrogen. Way too much nitrogen for our lawns and our waterways and everything else. We have big problems with over nitrification. Again, an organic product, it will be about 8 or 10, and that's a really good slow release nitrogen for the lawn. So these weed and feed products are high nitrogen, and plus with every little nitrogen molecule, they put an herbicide, they put a weed killer with it. So it's throwing it all over the lawn. So even if you don't have a weed that you want to kill, it's on that lawn area. And now we're finding a lot of those products in our waterways and stuff. So we call them dual combination products, weed and feed, moss control plus fertilizer, whatever they're trying to sell us. We want to do fertilizing with our organic fertilizer. And then I'll talk to you about weeds and moss control here a little bit later. But again, for all weed and moss problems, it's a lawn challenge that we need to focus in on. So we want to build up the health of the lawn, build up the thickness of the lawn, then start combating some of these other things. Or we're just going to kill weeds or moss, try to kill moss, and then have big bare spots because the lawn's not healthy enough to grow in those areas. So concentrate on your lawn first, then we'll go with trying to concentrate on getting rid of some of these little pests that you're having, okay? We also recommend every year an annual application of lime. This is dolomite lime. So lime is all it is naturally occurring either calcium or dolomite lime like this one is calcium and magnesium. Two elements that are leached from our soils when we have heavy rainfall. So as the heavy rainfall goes through our soils, it's taking away these elements and these minerals, and that makes our soils really acidic in the Pacific Northwest. So this lime application helps raise up our soil pHs, but also replenishes calcium and magnesium, which plants need just as much as sometimes nitrogen and phosphorus and potassium, just like our bodies need magnesium, our bodies need calcium, soils and plants need those elements also. So we need to replenish those elements. And I've had lawns green up just by putting lime down because the pH was changed enough to, in order to be able to let the plant get all the other nutrients that are available. So it's really important to add pH. Add lime to lawns. Sometimes it takes a little while for the pH to change. So it's a time process, but you want to get those elements down. And again, the power of putting down lime in order to help us with our mineralization is that a lot of times if people see their lawns not doing well, they just put way too much fertilizer down and the lawn doesn't do well still. And a lot of it because it's in a low range of pH. So even though those elements might be available, once it gets into a lower pH, like below 6, you can see that a lot of those elements become unavailable for the plant to be able to take up. Once we raise the pH back up to a favorable range, all those elements become available for the plant. So a lot of times if people are struggling with the lawn color and stuff, it's not a nitrogen problem, it's a pH problem, okay? And a lot of times to get a good read. Hey, Lab, yes, Cameron, go ahead.
Before you move on there, when is the best time to apply lime?
Great question. We usually recommend doing it if we can in early, late winter, early spring, because it takes a little while for those elements to start doing their stuff. So if people can put it down in December, January, February, even with those rains, the rains then start bringing these minerals back down into the soil profile so that those elements are available for the plant once the plant starts needing them in March, April, May, June. And again, it takes a little while for that pH to change. So if people do a little earlier, by the time the season starts rolling around, the pH has changed a little bit and those elements are available for you.
So is it too late in the year to do it now, or do you still recommend?
Another great question. If someone has not limed ever or in a long time and they're thinking they need to or something like that, go ahead and put it down now. You know, it's better sooner than later in order to be able to get those minerals down into the soil. But if they're thinking they want to fertilize, then they're going to have about a 4 to 6 week period in between a lime and a fertilizer application. So they don't want to go, oh, I need lime. So they put down lime today and then they go, oh, but I need to fertilize. And they do that in a week or something like that. They're going to, even though those are both positive things to do, they can actually bind themselves up and neither one of them become available if that happens and stuff. So, if they're going to fertilize, just make sure that they have enough time in between a liming and a fertilization. But yeah, right now, put some lime down if they have it. Yep, take advantage of it. So, and we actually, in my company, we put this time of year, we're putting lime down in around all of our drip systems and fruit trees. We put lime around all of our drip systems in raspberries, blueberries, strawberries, all those things. All these plants love calcium, especially we found it really a key in pears and apples. By having that additional calcium, the fruits are better. They're absolutely better. So lime is just, again, can be used in all of our gardening practices, but there's certain plants that respond really well to it. So, and if you're not sure about your pH, you can actually do a soil test and send a test in to be able to get that information. I recommend this one up in Burlington, Simply Soil Testing. I think it's like $15. They give you organic matter, they give you mineral content, they give you your pH, they'll give you recommendations on how much lime to put down to get your pH better. Really good information for a very inexpensive price. So, and a local company. So if you're not sure you wanna take that road, which is really important sometimes if it has been done for a while to kind of just give you a baseline, I really recommend Simply Soil Testing up in Burlington. Excuse me, glass of water here. Okay, so fertilizing, liming, also all organic fertilizers, like, you know, a lot of people use chicken manures and they use, you know, cow manures and stuff for fields for our agriculture and stuff. Everything that comes out of every animal isn't good for our soils. Even though these might be the cutest little animals we've ever seen in our lives that run around our yards, what comes out the back end needs to be treated as solid waste, okay? So it needs to be picked up as soon as possible, put into a plastic bag or something like that, and then put into the regular garbage. Please don't put it in your compost pile. Please don't dig holes and bury it in your yards and stuff like that. We are finding some of these, some of the things that come along with the bacteria and stuff that come along with animal waste. When it's left out there too long, gets rinsed off down into our stormwater system. So being timely and putting in solid waste is a huge key for just animal waste. So, but it's not organic fertilizer. It should not be treated like that. Okay. So first one's mowing. Second one's fertilizing. Third one is watering. And watering is probably the most difficult one for a lot of us to wrap our heads around. And like I've been up here in the Pacific Northwest for over 30 years now. And it seems to me when I first moved up here, it rained all the way through June, or all the way, as a matter of fact, up to like the 4th of July. I think that was like the joke, right? That it's going to rain probably 50-50 chance on the 4th of July. Usually on the 5th of July, it starts drying out. And about middle of August, we start getting the rain start coming back, and then we get into our fall rainy period and stuff. But it is showing now that we're having longer periods of time where we're having less water come out of the ground or come out of the sky in spring and summer. So now we really need to add water to our lawns to have a successful lawn. And I'll talk about the lawns going dormant here in a little bit, and that they will naturally go into this dormant period. But if they stay in that dormant period too long and they really don't have much moisture, they start thinning out, and then we get more weeds and moss. So we're finding that clients who say, I don't want weeds, or I want less weeds, and moss is a big problem, we're telling them, you're going to have to water during the summer times now. You can't just let it go dormant, because it's a perfect opportunity when the lawn's in this dormant state for these other critters to get in there and take hold and stuff. So if we're going to water, which is going to be needed if people want to have a nicer lawn here in the Pacific Northwest during the summertime, you need to know how much is coming out of your system. And really what we're trying to get is that we need to understand how long it takes to get 1 inch of water out of your system, because when it gets dry, we'd like to put 1 inch of water on the lawn per week in order to keep the lawn doing what it likes to do. Okay. So if we're going to do that, we got to measure the output of the irrigation system. So it doesn't matter what kind of sprinkler you have, they're all going to put out different amounts of water according to where you live, with the water pressure, and what type of a sprinkler you use. So what you have to do is put out cans or containers like this, cat food cans, tuna fish cans, stuff like that really work well. But you need to have enough of them to be able to put out onto your lawn, run the sprinkler for a certain amount of time, and then go and measure how much moisture came out of that system to see how long it's going to take you to get that 1 inch of moisture, right? So let's say you water for, and I'm just random throwing numbers out here, you water for an hour and you get a half of inch of water, you would know then that you need to water for 2 hours to get 1 inch, right? So there's some simple math going on, but it really becomes, you know, measuring all these containers out here, getting a median amount of what water's coming out, and then deciding how long it's going to take you to achieve that 1 inch of water. And again, different sprinklers have different outputs. I have an oscillator. This is what I use at my house. I like it because when it goes back and forth like this, it allows the moisture to sink in before it allows more moisture to come back on top. Sometimes with automatic systems, especially if there's a lot of these heads that pop up in a small area, they can put out a tremendous amount of water in an area very quickly. And then you're going to have that runoff happen on the lawn because the soil just can't take that much water in a long period of time. So with some of these guys, you might have to water for 5 minutes, turn it off, come back and water for 5 minutes, turn it off, something like that, in order to make sure that you're not getting water to just run off of the lawn because it's putting out too fast. And that's another reason I like the oscillator, because I've never had water running off my lawn by using an oscillator. Now, it takes me to achieve with my oscillator at my house 2.5 hours to get 1 inch. So it's a long time to get that 1 inch, but I know that all that water's been slowly allowed to sink in, and I'm going to get a good watering by doing it correctly with my oscillator. Okay. And we would like to see too, is if we can, to try to water 1 day a week with that 1 inch. Now, a lot of that depends on how deep your soil is. It also depends on how deep your root system is. But what we found is that if you have better soils, and even with a shallow root system, that if you water, instead of watering like every single day, or even watering a little bit, a couple times a week, that if you put all that moisture in so that it filled up the whole soil profile with moisture, that as the top half of the soil dries out during the rest of the week, the roots will actually go down deeper looking and mining that water. So you can actually train your roots to be deeper, which means you have a better lawn by allowing that soil to dry out a little bit on the top, so that when the moisture is down below, the roots will go down there and find it. Now, if this is dry soil down here, roots will not go down looking through dry soil to find moisture, okay? So that's why we need to fill up the whole soil profile. And then as it dries out, the roots will naturally go down as they have that moisture to get to and stuff like that. So, but if we're keeping the moisture right at the top of the soil surface, the roots don't have any reason to grow deeper. So you want to train your roots as much as possible to go as deep as possible, okay? And that's what we did with this client right here. Good soils, good mowing, good practices. And look at this, their roots 9 inches deep. This is a phenomenal grass plant. Look how thick and lush it is in the background. That is what we want our lawns to look like. If we have poor soils and poor growing conditions, the lawn on top is going to react just like this. It's surprising that this grass can grow at all because it almost has no root system and there's no good soils down here. But grasses are tough plants. They are tough plants. They will do okay in these conditions, but when we have conditions like this, this is when they thrive. And that's what we want. We don't want survival. We want thriving plants like this. So good soils, good watering, good practices, good training. And over time, this is the kind of lawn you will have. So it can be done. You just have to give it a little time sometimes, okay? But it's good watering. I recommend a soil probe. Man, I love these things. And I kind of put Stuber's distributing downtown Snohomish. This is where I get ours. Really solid. We paid a good price because you want a nice soil probe. But by using a soil probe, you actually just stick it into your soil profile after you're watering, pull it back out. And you can see in here how good you're watering. How deep did your water go down? How deep are your roots going down? And when we were doing this lawn here, we'd come by, you know, every 3 or 4 months and put it down and we'd go, oh, the roots are getting better. Oh, the roots are getting better. Oh, the roots are getting better. So it gives you a really good indicator how well you're doing your watering. And I use this all over the place. When I water my trees and shrubs, use my soil probe, go down the ground and go, oops, I need to add some more water because it only went down so far. Add some more water. Fantastic tool for giving you direct feedback on how well you're doing with your gardening practices and how good your soil is. You know, if you get your soil probe and you go in and after 2 inches, you're hitting like hard pan, you don't have very good soil. You might have to think about what you can do to make your soil better over time, or maybe even just redo it in order to get the results that you're looking for with your garden. But I love soil probes. Again, get a good one. Don't buy the cheap ones. The cheap ones you put in the ground, you twist it to pull it out and the whole thing turns on itself and collapses and stuff. So you need good metal, good edge on the bottom. They'll last you a lifetime. We love these things. We use these tools in our business practices every single day on just seeing how people are doing with their water and how their soils are down below. It gives you a direct correlation on how the plant's growing on top, okay? So I'll talk a little bit now about lawns going dormant, because grass plants are one of the only plants that have the ability that if they don't have enough moisture in their root system, they will just dehydrate themselves and go into a dormant state, okay? Now, all other plants won't do this. Any other plant that does not have enough moisture in its root system over time will just die, okay? It needs to have moisture. But grass plants, being this unique kind of plant, will just go into this dormant state and just hang out for a while till moisture comes in. And it's kind of built over eons of time, you know, where in our grasslands, they have all the spring rains where they grow lush, and then they have the hot summers where they go in the dormant state, and then they come back in springtime or in fall time when the fall rains come back and the conditions are conducive for it. And that's how they've developed themselves. So all grass plants work this way, and especially in the Pacific Northwest. So a couple things about it, if you're going to think about letting your lawn go dormant, A is that if it's going to go into this dormant stage or this golden stage, you want it as healthy as possible before going into that, okay? So mow correctly, do everything you can, give it a little bit of fertilizer, make sure you're liming or whatever it is, so that the lawn is as tough as possible going into this dormancy, because it's a stressful period for the lawn, so that when it's coming out of it, it's as healthy as possible, okay? And if you're going to let your lawn go dormant, you have to have minimal traffic on it. So you cannot have, say, I'm just going to let my lawn go dormant, but I'm going to have my kids rugby team out there practicing all summer long, because without having moisture in its leaves, the grass plant is in a very delicate state. Okay. So it needs moisture for resiliency. It needs moisture for tenacity. That's what makes those cells work. So if it doesn't have the moisture it needs and it goes into this dormant state, and then we have a bunch of traffic all over it, you're going to destroy the plant and the crowns of these things. And you're going to have to do a major renovation in fall time. Some plants will come back, but it will not come back like it needs to not have a bunch of weeds and moss moving in. So if you're going to let it go golden, you have to minimize traffic on there. And if especially animals, if you have dogs, you almost can't let it go in this dormant state, or they just really do a ton of damage to it. So lawns with moisture are better able to resist the what animals do to when they're running around and stuff like that. So minimal traffic if you're going to let it go golden. And if we have extended periods of time, like we've had several summers ago, where we actually went like 4 to 5 months with just a little bit of moisture, to just give it your lawn 1 inch of moisture once a month. So not just to, not to keep it green, but what you're doing is just giving a little bit of moisture to keep some moisture in that soil system, so that when fall time comes around, it can just start rehydrating itself as quick as possible. Okay, so the thought is here is that if we're going past a 4 to 6 weeks and we still haven't had moisture, please water it. You won't see it green up, because the lawn will not green up until fall time, when three things happen. One is that it has cooler conditions like September and October. Two is that we have less, we have less daylight. And that's a major response for the plant, is that once the daylight gets shorter, the plant will respond favorably by coming out of it. And then when it has moisture, day length, and coolness, the lawn will recover it. It happens every fall time, okay? But we need to keep some moisture in there until that fall time rolls around. Because this is what happens. As soon as there's not moisture in the lawn will start going dormant, okay? And if this starts happening to your lawn in, let's say, May, and you go, I don't want my lawn to go dormant, I need to water it, it will not come out of that dormancy, because it needs to have the cooler temperature and the day length. It's not going to go in and out, of dormancy. It does it once, waits for the fall season to come around. So once it goes into dormancy, you can't get it to come out of it. You just have to deal with it at that point. But with this lawn, you can tell that these roots right here, not enough moisture. But down here where all the water kind of sloped down, there's enough moisture for the lawn to be able to do its thing. And especially was thriving underneath the tree where it was shadier, because it had less intense heat to pull the moisture out of it. So you can see how well your lawn is doing throughout the season by just noticing where it might be going dormant in certain areas. And you know that that soil is probably not as healthy as you would like it to be, okay? And most lawns, again, dormancy, it almost takes this golden color. That's why we call it that golden period. It's 4 to 6 weeks, 8 weeks maximum that it can stay in this golden period before it starts having problems and starts thinning itself out, because now it's dying, okay? It can be dormant for a while, but it has to be a short period. Then it needs moisture. But if it doesn't get it, it starts thinning out. And then you'll find that you're going to have nothing but broadleaf plants that you don't want and moss moving in, okay? So that's why I tell a lot of clients now, if they're thinking that the moss or weeds are like their biggest challenge and they, you know, they want to stay on top of those, I really tell them you can't let your lawn go dormant in summer now. You're going to have to water 1 inch a week to keep your lawn looking good, or at least keep it in this growing state, or you're going to get a lot of these plants back. So now it becomes a management decision on you as a homeowner, saying, you know what, I don't want to water, so I'm just gonna let it go dormant, but I know I'm gonna have more things to deal with in the future. And if you do it over several years, sometimes the whole lawn can be invaded by, or be a majority of these broadleaf plants or moss, or you're gonna say, you know what, I'm just gonna commit to watering correctly, watering as best I can, 1 day a week, checking my moisture and stuff like that, so that my lawn stays as a growing entity to combat other plants that want to move in there when my lawn usually goes dormant. So there you have it. So water deeply and infrequently to keep the lawn growing during the months that we don't have moisture come out of the sky. Okay, so now we talked about mowing, right? Mowing a little bit differently. Talked about just using organic fertilizers, no more weed in feeds. Talked about watering, and watering then becomes a management decision on whether you're going to keep your lawn not growing during the season or let it go dormant, and then the ramifications from letting it go dormant also. But really, it doesn't matter if you're going to let it go dormant or not, how you're mowing, how you're fertilizing, every lawn responds positively from a physical cultural practice we call aerations, okay? And an aeration is physically just taking a machine over the lawn and pulling out small plugs. Can be done in spring or fall. Right now is perfect, absolutely perfect aeration season. Right now through probably mid to late May. And if we get the cooler weather sticking around, we've even had people who can aerate up into June. You just want the lawn to be growing, because it's a physical beating up of the lawn, and you want the lawn to have the time during spring and fall, if you're gonna do it in fall, so the lawn can recover from this physical beating, okay? So you want it to be growing during the spring and fall, best time to do it. Plus you want moisture in the soil to get your best plugs and stuff. But by doing an aeration, you're actually alleviating compaction, which means that the roots can be better, because now they have open air spaces for air and gas exchange to happen on, and lawns respond really positively to it. So you always want to use a hollow tined aerator. I got like a little hollow tine, just one of these guys that came off a machine that looks like this one. And you want a hollow tine. You do not want a solid tine, because a solid tine, and sometimes people will buy a home lawnmowers like a John Deere or something like that, that's a rideable mower. And then they give you a little aeration thing on the back that's just like a bunch of solid tines that just poke holes while it's going behind the mower. But a solid tine aeration means that that piece of metal is driven in the soil, and it throws all that soil and compacts it to the side so that it makes room for this solid tine. So you're never alleviating compaction. And that's the number one thing you want to do with an aeration, is kind of alleviate this compaction, allow for more gas exchange. So that's why you want to use a hollow tine, because you physically want the lawn to have little teeny plugs on top of it after you've run this aerator over. That means that you have a nice clean channel going in to the soil to be able to get the maximum benefits from this aeration. So if you do it right and you go over it several times, you'll actually find it almost looks like you had a goose convention all over your lawn. You have these little plugs everywhere, but this is what you want. It shows you how deep your roots are going down. It shows you kind of your thatch layer. It shows you a lot of things about what's going on with your lawn by just pulling these little plugs. But the maximum thing you can do is, you by physically pulling this little plug out, we get air, we get gas exchange, we get nutrients that can go in these holes. If you want to fertilize at that time, you can put lime down in these holes so it directly goes straight into a hole instead of having to travel down through the soil surface. Many, many benefits from opening up this channel, okay? And they have found, even if you have a nasty thatch layer, and some people want to use a thatcher, and I don't recommend thatchers for removing thatch. I'll talk about a thatch a little bit later for moss, but I don't recommend, if you have heavy thatch, using a thatcher. Get an aerator, beat it up, poke holes directly through that thatch. And you will find that once we have these air channels, you get nutrients, you can get oxygen in there, you'll get a better root system, and it'll become a denser lawn because of just beating up and physically going through the thatch and then letting the underneath start to do what it wants to do and stuff. So even with a bad thatch layer, use an aerator. But we recommend an annual aeration, either spring or fall. Some people with really bad soils are aerating twice a year and they're getting better results. So, but it doesn't matter. Just do it once a year if you can to really get the benefits from opening up your soil profile, okay? And then if you really want to do it right, while you have the soil profile opened up and have this aeration going in, then you're going to throw out some grass seed. We call it overseeding because it's really just throwing seed over the existing lawn, right? So you put it over there, it sifts itself down into the root system and onto the soil surface, starts germinating, and you will thicken up your lawn by just putting seed down. So highly recommend aeration and overseeding to help thicken up the lawn at all times, because again, a thick lawn is our best competitor for moss and weeds. So 4 to 5 pounds is what we recommend. Best times, again, April through mid-June. So we're in our prime time right now. September through mid-October would be our fall season window. But you need to understand too, that if you're seeding in springtime, all these new little grasses will need to be watered all summer long in order to establish themselves. So you cannot overseed in spring and then let your lawn go dormant in fall or in summertime, or you're gonna just let all those little seedlings die off. So it takes them one full season to get themselves established enough to be able to go into a dormant season. So if you choose to seed in spring, you will have to water that entire summer season. Question, Kevin?
Yeah, there's a couple questions here. They're asking, what are the best times of day to water?
Oh, good one, best times of day. So a lot of it for us in the Pacific Northwest is how hot it's going to get, okay? Because heat means that we're going to get the evaporation going on. So if we're talking like most time when we think we're going to be watering around here, which would be in our summer months, if you can, water in the morning, okay? Water in the morning when it's nice and cool, and you get that water to be able to sink into the soil as much as possible before it starts evaporating away with the heat and stuff like that. In springtime, if we have cooler weather, a lot of times you can water anytime during the day and still get that same reaction of not having, you know, the water being evaporated away and stuff like that. So early morning is the best. Cloudy days are okay. You can water almost all the time during the day. But the main goal is to get moisture down into our soil surface before it starts evaporating away. So mornings are the best if we can. If you cannot, for just whatever reasons, and you have to water at night, You can water at night because, again, you're not going to get the evaporation, but it just can't be a constant thing, or you'll have it where the lawn stays wet too long. The lawn likes to dry out a little bit. So you put water on it in the morning, it sinks in, the lawn has a chance to dry out, the lawn thrives. A lot of times in our afternoons, we'll sometimes get some winds coming up, and that'll evaporate it too. So that's why mornings are the best, or any other time during the day, as long as it's not windy.
Is that true for other areas of your yard, like your flower beds and your vegetable beds and things like that too?
Yep. If you can put the moisture down into the soil and like fill up your water reservoir, so the plant has a maximum amount of water that it can use during the day because it's been filled up, you'll get maximum growth. And so especially like vegetables, I highly recommend watering in the morning, man. Fill up that soil profile. You see your plants explode because then water is not a limiting factor. Okay. And that's what we're looking for. If it's got the sunshine and it's got everything it needs, water cannot be a limiting factor with vegetables. So makes a big difference. But good question. Yep. Really good question. And just kind of throw out. I can't show it right now. I don't have the smart watering one, but you know, they have the natural pest and disease control. They also have the right plant in the right place. And they have a really good one about smart watering. So a ton more information about when to water, types of sprinklers and stuff like that, that you can find in these pamphlets. Okay. So when we're going to overseed two, we want to use premium grass seed. Okay. I recommend go to a garden center to get your grass seed. Don't go to a big box store. Because at the big box store, they'll sell you the same seed that they sell in New Orleans, and they sell in New York, and they sell in Chicago, anywhere around the world. And we have different growing conditions up here in the Pacific Northwest. We actually have very unique growing conditions. So we want to use a grass blend of seed that has perennial rye grasses in it and fine fescue grasses, okay? And like this one on this bag, and they'll either say Northwest blend or sun and shade blend. They'll have, you know, a kind of a Northwest sounding name. We can see like this one, there's like five different kinds of seeds. So they have two or three different kinds of perennial rye, two or three different kinds of fine fescues, all a little bit different, but when they're grown together, you can't tell their difference and they just make a really nice lawn. Okay, so that's why we want to use a blended grass, get a premium grass so you don't have any weed seeds or inert matter in there. Might be a little bit more, but you will get the results that you're looking for with your germination and establishment. So don't buy grass seeds that have Kentucky bluegrass in it. Doesn't grow up here. Zoysia grass doesn't grow up here. So don't get blends with all these other exotic grasses in it. We want it perennial rye grasses, fine fescues, a Northwest blend for your best results, okay? And so now you've opened up your lawn with an aeration. So now you have a nice hole opened up. You put some seed down. Some of that seed goes down in those holes. Some of it stays on top of the grass. It's all going to germinate. And the number one thing you can do to get the best results ever of your lawn is to lay down a fine layer of compost, okay? A really fine compost. You don't want a bunch of big chunks on it. Cedar Grove actually sells a top dressing compost in their bags. So sometimes it's easier for people to get the bags. And I think I saw them at Fred Meyer and stuff. But it's a fine compost and you spread that over your lawn. Like we do this for some clients. We put the compost in the wheelbarrow, roll it out to where we want it, spread it out with a shovel. And then you take a rake and you rake it back and forth until you really just see the grass again. You get compost down into those holes, directly into your holes. So now you have that compost where you want it in your soil profile, but you don't want to bury your grass. So again, a quarter inch thick is not very much. So it really doesn't take too much of this product and you will get amazing results by just laying it out, raking it in, get it in the holes, cover up the existing seed that you put out there. And once you add water, your lawn will literally explode in front of your eyes with all this new growth. So it's the best thing you can do, especially if you have poor soils, because this compost right down in those holes, right down where the roots can get to it, literally within a couple of weeks, you'll be amazed at the color and how things are starting to thicken up. So really take advantage of this time of year by aerating. If you want to do even better, aerate overseed. If you really want to get the maximum results for any work that you're putting into it, an investment that you're putting into it, top dress with a fine compost on top of it. And then with the aeration, seeding, and top dressing, your lawn will be really moving towards what you want it to be. Okay. Now, for if you have really poor soils and you've been struggling with either poor drainage or maybe the lawn dries out way too fast in summertime because it doesn't have good organic matter layer in it, or it's mostly just glacier till and stuff, we have been using this product called Axis DE. It's diatomaceous earth. It's a natural product that's formed that they mine. And what it is like it's shells that don't break down. And so what we've been using it for is that we will aerate a lawn, come back and rake this access into the holes, and then put a little bit of compost on top of that. And usually with an aeration, the hole is opened up, and then over time it just collapses on itself, because that's what soils do. But with this access in the soils, the hole never collapses fully. And so you get better water movement, you get better air movement, you get better root growth. Look up this Axis DE on the on the internet. You'll be pretty amazing how it not only helps with water movement through soil, so it helps with poor drainage, but it also helps with water retention. So it gives you the best of both worlds through this diatomaceous earth. So we've been using it. Some lawns might have to use it two or three times. Well, put one thing out there, if you're gonna use this product, you need to wear a mask or a respirator because it's very fine. There's shells. It's a fine dust sometimes too, part of the product. You do not want to be breathing this product in. And it says this on the instructions. So read the instructions, but really nice product. Sold through Hendrickas Fertilizer. So they have a huge supply of it, sold in the retail market and stuff like that. But really nice product that if you're going to aerate and you really want to get better results out of it, put some of this down and then do your compost on top of it. You'll be really happy with the results, especially if you're going to do it a couple times. Okay. This is what it looks like. It almost looks like cat litter, but it never breaks down. And that's the beauty of it, is that these shells just kind of keep their structure. So water constantly moves in, air constantly moves in. It just doesn't seal itself up like a regular hole will. Pretty amazing stuff. Pretty amazing stuff. So mowing, fertilizing, watering, aeration, overseed, and top dressing, which is a cultural practice that we recommend again once a year if you can, to just keep the health of the lawn going up. But sometimes people still after that think they need to use some type of a pesticide. So if we're going to, we just need to be mindful of it and always think twice before using these products. And really, it's always the last result, the last resort. It's never the first thing that we do. We don't go out there and go, oh, I got a dandelion, I just need to use a weeding feed. It's like, no. Work on the health of your lawn first, then let's talk about how we're going to deal with the dandelions. So again, with natural lawn care, do not use any weeding feed products. Please, no more of these products. We're finding them all in our waterways, because any pesticide, doesn't matter, insecticide, fungicide, they actually damage the soil by killing the beneficial organisms in there. A fungicide's killing funguses that are growing in our soils that we want in there. So as they damage soil, they damage the lawn health, and that means that the plants aren't there to stop the pollution that can be moving back and forth with water that moves across them into our lakes and waterways and stuff. So be very mindful of that too. Again, I've mentioned this several times, we want to crowd out our problem entities, be it moss or broadleaf plants, by having a thick, tenacious lawn going on. So that's what we're always going for, is the lawn being as healthy and growing as vigorously as it can. And that minimizes this thing. So that's what we want to do, but we also might have to except a few weeds, because any plant that's growing like this tall, there's other plants that want to come in there. So you'll never have a weed-free lawn. I don't even care if people are using weeding feeds all the time and all the pesticides they can get their hands on. They will constantly be using some of these things because plants move in on our lawns. As much as possible, removing weeds by hand or just spot spraying, so we're minimizing any product damage, okay? Because what we're finding is that we have off-target problems with all the pesticides that we're using. And off-target problems are things that happen when unexpectedly, right? So we put down a product and we go, oh, we want this to do this. And then something else happens. We go, uh-oh, that wasn't supposed to happen. And it happens a lot with pesticides. We put something down and all of a sudden we're seeing more problems. And in Clearview, this vet had put this on his sign: pets don't mix well with lawn care products, because he was seeing animals coming in with lesions, with their hair falling out, with scabbing, problems with respiratory and stuff like that. And he equated it to the products that we were putting down our lawns, that these little organisms are rolling around in and licking themselves and stuff like that and causing bigger problems. So that's what we need to eliminate is off-target problems, which usually means that we just don't want to use those products because they all innately have a problem. When the EPA says that a pesticide can be sold to the public, it doesn't say it's safe. There's nothing on any label that's ever sold on a pesticide that says it's safe because none of these products are safe. What they're saying is that the risks are outweighed by any benefits that the product can give us. Okay, so we're saying, oh, you're gonna get some benefits and there's gonna be some risks, but the benefits are outweighed. A lot of times we don't wanna have any risk and those benefits don't outweigh the risk. So we just don't wanna use them at all. Because what we're finding is big problems with all these products that we don't see, okay? Here's they did this at King County. The USGS went and they surveyed our water systems after a spring rain, after they knew that people went down and bought a lot of products at big box stores. So they were able to get some of the records from the big box stores and saw this huge surge of, like, you know, springtime comes around, all of a sudden their sales of all the pesticides go through the roof. Then they went out and tested the water and they found 23 different pesticides flowing through rivers, streams, tributaries, lakes, whatever it is. The Puget Sound is full of all these things, including in 100% found right here is all the weed and feed products, dicamba, MCPP, look at that, diazinon, which was an insecticide found in 100% of all the waterways. So we are finding insecticides, we are finding herbicides, we are finding fungicides in all of our waterways, 23 different ones. And again, in a lot of these, they're found in every single waterway we have are these products. So we just have to stop using them is the number one thing. And they're not needed as long as we're doing things well and trying to focus in on the health of our plant material. Question?
Yep, got a question about a certain product. Axicide, does that ring a bell? AXISDE?
No, what kind of, can they tell us what it is? Is it a herbicide, insecticide, fungicide? Do they know?
Kari, would you like to talk? I can allow you to talk if that helps you explain it a little more.
Yeah, hi. No, I was asking, maybe I typed it in there wrong. I was asking about that product that he was just talking about before, the Access DE, because he was talking about it needing to use a respirator to put it down on the soil, but the stuff that was the diatomaceous earth product.
Correct.
Is it safe to use when you have pets and kids? Is it just like the day of you'd want to keep them away? That was my question.
Okay, good question. Yeah, so if you're using the Access, you put it down and it's mostly because it's shells and very fine shells. They actually sell diatomaceous earth as a natural insecticide for like slugs, I mean, for ants and stuff, where it's a physical barrier. So they go onto it. It's like very sharp shells and then they back away. Some people use diatomaceous earth for slugs and snails. It does the same thing. You put it around the plants. Once they kind of try to crawl over it, because it's such fine that it's almost like razor sharp for them that it bothers them and they don't like it and they move away from it. So in those two instances, it's a physical barrier for those critters. So for us, because it's very fine like that, we just don't want to breathe in that product while we're using it and get those things into our lungs, right? Because it can still do damage. So once it gets on the ground and you water it in that first time, don't have to worry about it. There's gonna be no problems with it because now it's on the soil, it's been watered in, all those little fines are now on the soil surface. There will be no problems with anybody interacting with that product. But when it's in its, when you're laying it down, it'll kind of be puffy because it's, before it settles, that's when you just have to be careful using it and breathing it in. But other than that, it's a fantastic product once it's watered in, no problems to worry about.
Fabulous, thank you.
Yep, thank you. Okay, good one, that was a really good one. I appreciate you bringing that up because it is sometimes a mixed message, right? It's just like, well, you don't want to be breathing it in, but it's fine for everything else. So it's just, and again, for most of these products, I read the labels, and I'll talk about that here in a second. It doesn't matter what it is. We just need to read the labels, understand what we're using, either fertilizer, pesticides, whatever we're doing. because the company's put a lot of information into trying to get it so that we can understand how to use all these products in the best manner, so there's minimal challenges with it. Okay. So I put this on here, grow smart, grow safe. It doesn't matter what products we're going to use in our landscapes for a pesticide, fungicides, insecticides, molluscicides, mammaliacides, herbicides. They sell some products now that are organic. Like there's an organic insecticide made from pyrethians, right? Which is a pyrethian made from our chrysanthemum, which is just a flower. So it's all organic. A lot of people use pyrethians in their gardening practices, but if they read the label, they'll find that pyrethians are a non-selective insecticide. So if you're trying to kill aphids on a plant with pyrethians and there's ladybugs there, you're gonna actually kill your ladybugs too. So even though it's all organic, there's some off-target challenges with it. And so that's why you always want to understand whatever you're using. And that's what this Grow Smart, Grow Safe website is. You can just Google up Grow Smart, Grow Safe. Gives you all this information about all these different products that are coming to the market and stuff like that, because they come on the market all the time. And a lot of them have fantastic slick marketing campaigns, but you need to understand what the products do, what their risks are when you're using it. They give you these fantastic charts to say, hey, like this one's EcoSmart Organic Pesticide Rose and Flower. It uses peppermint, rosemary oil, sodium lauryl sulfate, and thyme oil, which, you know, all naturally occurring products. And the signal word is that pretty good thing. There's a lot of products down here like this one made from citric acid that gives you a red one. It might mean that the citric acid isn't bad for the environment, but you might look to say, oh my gosh, if I get citric acid in my eyes when I'm using it, there can be bad problems from that. And that is actually the off-target problem, is that I don't use it correctly. I splash it in my eyes and now I've got problems and stuff. So it gives you all that information about ones that are pretty cool, ones that maybe are still okay that you need to just use a little more thoughtfully and stuff like that. But fantastic, fantastic information, including, you know, your lowest hazard to your highest hazards that you don't want to use. They give you the active ingredients, signal words, fantastic information for you to make an informed decision on any product that you want to use in your yard, right? Because no one's forcing us to use these products. We go out and buy them ourselves. And once we use them, and if we don't like it, now it's hazardous waste. It's not something you can throw in your garbage can. It's something that needs to be disposed of correctly, okay? So now if you decide to use an herbicide, okay? So you're saying, you know what? I got some problems. I just think my herbicide, I'm doing everything else, but I need to use a weed killer. Again, it's always the last option. Get your lawn healthy as possible, first of all, before it's trying to kill things. Or if the lawn's not healthy, those things will move right back in because the lawn's not competing against it, okay? You always select the proper product for the job, because in herbicides, there's pre-emergence, there's post-emergence, there's selectives, there's non-selectives, there's powders, there's liquids, there's all these different things that need to be known what they are and how they work in order to get the best results. And then I tell people, first of all, you read the label. The second thing you'll do before using that product is to read the label. And the third thing you'll do before using that product is read the label, because you have to understand what you're getting into and how to best use that product with minimal damage. Always wear protective clothing, and it'll tell you in the label what you should be using. And most of them recommend rubber boots, rubber gloves, long pants, long sleeve shirts, eye protection. You're protecting all your skin as much as possible. You're protecting your eyes as much as possible. Some of them will say use a mask, you know, like an N95 when you're mixing it, because you don't want to breathe in the powder and stuff like that. You have to know how you're using the product and how to best mix the product, because usually the most toxic time is when you have the product in its unmixed form and you're mixing it, right? So if you're globbing it in there and all of a sudden splashing in your face, that's when you could have problems. So you always wear protective clothing, always follow the rules. And I say, use a little bit more if you have it, because more is better with protective clothing, okay? Make sure you have proper timing. Most of these herbicides will say, hey, we're gonna get rain within a day. You can't spray because it'll be washed off and then you just find that in the waterways and it doesn't kill the plant. So proper timing is a key. And then you always spray with care. And a quick little story here. I have some friends who live in Seattle, her and her husband, and they also have a home over in Winthrop. And in Winthrop, they have some weeds over there that are noxious weeds that by state law, they have to stay on top of. They cannot let them get, they cannot let their whatever whatever weeds they have on their property, they cannot not allow those weeds to spread. So they have to do some major weeding over in their place in Winthrop to make sure these noxious weeds do not get out of control. So they use glyphosate over there, one of the trade names, the most popular trade names, Roundup, okay? Very popular product. And so they had it over there using it for those weeds over there as part of their weed management strategy. And he said, you know what, we got dandelions in the yard in Seattle and I've already got this product, I'm just gonna use that. And she said, well, Roundup is a non-selective post-emergent herbicide. It doesn't say it work. It doesn't say good plant, bad plant, whatever gets on, it kills. And he said, I'm really good with target practice. And she said, okay, she didn't want to get into an argument and stuff. So he went over and got it, brought it home. And this is what he did to their yard. Because this is a non-selective post-emergent that doesn't say good plant, bad plant. He killed the grass around every one of those dandelions because of the overspray, because, you know, that's just what it does. And he had extra products, so he decided to do the neighbors also. This was a big problem in the neighborhood when this happened. And the thing about this is, we saw this, right? It's like, oh my gosh, look what happened to that lawn. That's terrible. That's an off-target problem. Most of these things we don't see, you know? So when I showed you that 23 different pesticides in our waterways, you don't go to your local river and go, oh my gosh, I see all those pesticides in there. You don't see them, but they're floating in there and stuff. So the visual ones are the off-target problems. We're just going, oh my gosh, it's the non-visual ones that we have to be very careful about because we just have no idea what's going on with them, okay? So if you have any pesticides you want to get rid of, Snohomish County through the Household Hazardous Waste Program sets up either places you can go to, or sometimes you can bring them to them in order to get rid of any pesticides you do not want to use. Now, a couple things you need to know, they need to be in their original containers because they need to know what they're dealing with, right? So you can't like put it into a coffee can and bring down whatever you had in the garage and stuff. They need to be in their original containers. Go to that website, check it out, and they'll give you methods that you can safely dispose of any pesticides you don't want to use. Question, Cameron?
Yeah, I think that last photo might have brought up a question for someone. They asked, it's not related to pesticides, but maybe those burn marks that you see with dog urine.
Yeah.
And wondering if there's any way we can avoid that or help out with that.
Not have dogs. Yep. The number one way to not have dog urine things is not have dogs.
Not an option.
That is not an option. That's right. We were just talking about that earlier with Cameron and myself. We love our puppy dogs. So what happens is that when you see those marks in the lawn, it's because the urine is such a high salt concentration that it's literally pulling the moisture out of the grass blades. So the lawn's turning into this straw looking color, right? And that's usually what we see when we see the urine spots. So it's too high concentration of salts. And the same thing sometimes will happen with fertilizers. If people over fertilize, the lawn will turn all these funky colors because it's literally through osmosis, just pulling moisture from the grass blades instead of the grass blades having moisture in there and be able to do their things like that. So big problem. So what we have to do with the urine marks is flush out that high salt concentration. So it might be just taking a hose and just flushing out over a couple of days. Once the salts start flowing through the soil profile and it gets into a more of a balanced state, a lot of times those areas will green up because it's nitrogen, and that's, you know, it's urine is that, you know, urine has nitrogen in it, uric acid and stuff like that. So the lawn will sometimes grow in these little green puffs when you, after it gets in this balance, because now the plant not only is in a better way with the water movement, but also now has nitrogen available that it can use pretty readily because it's in a liquid form and stuff like that. So number one thing to do is just flush out those areas. And especially if they're going in an area all the time, that might need regular flushing because then it can start getting smelly too, because it's just not good. So flushing of those areas is the main thing when you're seeing that on the grass. But I see that all the time too. People think, you know, what's going on with my lawn? And it's just the dogs are just using it as their bathroom. And and the salts are pulling the moisture out of the grass blades. Great question. Really good take. Thank you guys very much. So a couple of the plants that are biggest challenges, lawn weeds, dandelions. You should know they're a sign of compacted soils. Dandelions are on this earth to break up heavy compacted soils. And then when they die off, they add calcium to the soil profile. So whatever plant comes in after the dandelions has better soils to grow in and has calcium as a nutrient available for it. So really, dandelions are a great plant. They're just really a good sign that we have heavy compacted soils and that our lawns aren't growing as well as they want to. So aeration is a big key. If you have compacted soils, we recommend that. It won't make dandelions go away, but it will make it that the lawn's healthier in order to be able to outcompete more of the dandelions. But dandelions are a pain for everybody, okay? So they are just everywhere. And clover has a bad rap. And I actually like clover in lawns. It was sold in lawn mixtures way back when, before the herbicide companies said, you know what, you need to kill all broadleaf plants in your lawns, and you need to use this product to do it, or you're a bad person. They also started a marketing campaign saying that if you have clover, you'll have flowers. If you have flowers, you'll have bees. If you have bees, you have stingers. And if you have stingers, someone's going to die. And so it really kind of set everyone into a panic mode that they couldn't have clover because no one wants to get stung and have a reaction to it and die and stuff. So really nasty campaigns to get people to not want clover. But it was sold in grass mixtures, like I said, before the herbicides were introduced. And it actually is a nitrogen fixer. It's a plant that brings nitrogen from the atmosphere, doesn't have to get it from the soil, brings it from the atmosphere, brings it down in the root system, and then gives it to all of its friends, which includes grass plants. So I think, and I've seen lawns that are greener with clover growing in them than without clover growing in them. And so I like clover as a lawn that adds natural nitrogen, helps thicken up the lawn. People have a problem with the clover flowers. I tell them just mow more often in springtime to cut off those flowers, but it's just a seasonal thing when they're doing their flowers. So just try to cut them off more, but fantastic plant. And when you have this much clover in a lawn, you cannot pull it out. You're gonna have to spray with an herbicide, which is, that's a pretty nasty spray. Because the only two ways you can get rid of weeds is one by hand pulling or spot spraying them with a traditional product. So anyone that we can hand pull, that includes dandelions, plantains, black medic. There's like about five or six that really come out readily by just hand pulling. We want to do all those as much as possible by hand pulling. There's some that we call creepers that have their root system pretty tenacious, that if you try to pull them, it actually sends a signal to the plant that it's under attack, and it'll actually be even more vigorous growing and stuff. And that includes clover and buttercup. Okay, so if people don't want those, you're gonna have to spot spray those areas with a traditional herbicide in order to try to knock them back. But for me, it's a tolerance thing. Again, if most people don't notice they have clover in their lawns until the flowers come up, but I have noticed a lot of lawns that when the lawns go dormant in summertime, the patches of area that have clover and grass together don't go dormant. You know what I mean? So most lawns can stay out of that dormant state by just having clover growing in them too. So there's a lot of positives by having clover growing in them and just not thinking that everything broadleaf needs to be killed in our lawns, because that's really more of a natural lawn. But also part of a natural lawn is that we have other grasses that grow in our lawns that are not our ones that we really like our perennial ryegrasses and our fine fescues. But we do not have crabgrass, so please never buy crabgrass killers. The pesticide companies have got us to think that any grass that is that we don't like in our lawns is a crabgrass, and that's not right. There's nothing you can do to kill these things. They're just different kind of grasses. So we have like our Poa annua right here. We have some bent grasses that kind of just grow over the soil surface, more prostate. They're not just sitting up tall like we like to see them. This little Poa annua, it was such a problem for our lawns for golf courses that a lot of the golf courses now just grow Poa annua as their greens grass. And even the big golf tournament they had down with the Chambers Bay, they had a lot of complaints about the greens during the tournament. And they got permission to just grow Poa annua as their greens, and the greens are really nice now. So it's a weed when it's in our regular lawns because it gets these little seed heads when it grows tall enough, but they can use it on golf courses now because they keep it so closely cut that they don't get these little seed heads and stuff. But you will see some of these grasses come into our lawns naturally because they just get blown in from all of our native areas and stuff like that. But they're usually lighter color, different grass blade types and stuff like that. And it drives people crazy. A lot of it is like, you know what? Use a regular fertilizer. I mean, use like a natural fertilizer on a regular basis, and you'll keep the greenness up because they have the nitrogen in order to kind of mask them. But every lawn has these weed grasses in them. Nothing to do to like kill them off. Okay, so I'm going to finish off here with moss and moles. Two of our biggest challenges up here in the Pacific Northwest, and why most people just, the lawns drive them crazy. First of all, let's talk about moss. The reason that we have moss is that we live in a rainforest. We've taken away most of the forest, now we just live in rain. But you know, but if you go over to the Ho River rainforest, the Olympic Peninsula over there, moss grows on everything. It grows on everything, every plant on the ground, every rock, anything that is there, moss is growing on, because it's Mother Nature's big sponge. It collects all the moisture that comes out on a heavy rainfall, and then it slowly releases it back to the environment instead of just having that water wash away everything through major flooding. So moss in itself is a very impactful plant in the Pacific Northwest for just keeping our soils and our plants and our environment protected from Mother Nature's harsh storms. And it will grow anywhere where other plants don't do very well. So anywhere that's really shady, anywhere that's really slopy, that other plants struggle in, moss will become the dominant plant, okay? And we'll come out in springtime, we'll go, oh, I got a little bit of moss in my grass. And then you look a little bit more and you go, wow, I got a little bit of grass, but I got some moss here. And then you'll even look and you'll go, oh my gosh, in my moss lawn, I have little patches of grass in my moss lawn, because that's what moss will do over time, especially in dormant lawns or lawns that are have poor drainage during the winter time, where moss becomes a dominant plant in those conditions, okay? So that's why we have moss. Now, if you want to get rid of it, if your main goal is to get rid of the moss in your yard, this is what you have to do in order to get rid of the moss in the lawn, okay? First of all, they sell products that they say here, get rid of moss all the time. This one says right here, kills lawn moss quickly. None of these products, you should know, these guys are liars. Liars, liars, pants on fires, because nothing kills moss, okay? These products are usually made with iron, like this one, 7% iron. What that iron does is that when it goes down onto the lawn, just like the dog urine, it sucks the moisture out of the moss, okay? Because it's a high concentrate of a salt, and that blackens the moss because it's weakened now. It doesn't have moisture in the moss and stuff like that. So when it's in this weakened condition though, it's a lot easier to remove, okay? So if people have a lot of moss, I do recommend using one of these products to turn it black, and I'll show you a slide here pretty soon. It always turns black, and that means that the moss has been damaged but not killed. Now it's in a very weakened state that you can physically remove it. A lot of people try to use rakes to remove moss and it doesn't work. I tell people you'll just get blisters and frustration by trying to hand rake it out. You need to get a thatching machine. And I mentioned this earlier about, I don't recommend that thatching machine for thatch removal, but I recommend it for moss removal because it has all these little metal tines underneath this deck around here. And you have this lever where you take this deck right onto the soil surface. And while these little tines are going round and round and round and round, it's actually scraping the moss off of the soil surface and bring it to the soil surface instead of just scraping off the top where it's been damaged from the moss control, okay? And so by taking this machine over, you'll see huge amounts and piles of moss come up behind the machine because it's physically scraping it off the soil, bringing it back up to the soil surface. And you're gonna just see mounds and mounds of all this moss over your lawn. And you'll see big piles behind it while you're doing it. All that needs to be raked up. All that old moss needs to be raked up. All that old fiber needs to be raked up. And then you'll see all these bare patches, thin patches, because you have beat up your lawn really well. But you have to. If you don't do that, if you don't take this machine over and really physically remove the moss will come back, because the iron burning the plant, it's like us getting a sunburn. Our skin is really flaky and it's red and it's irritated and stuff like that. But after a short period of time, it recovers from it. And the same thing happens with a burn on the moss. It looks bad. It's black. It's weakened. It's flimsy. But it will come back from that moss control, just like our skin does when we get a sunburn. But this time it's really mad and it brings all of its friends. Okay. Plus, you should know that the iron that's used in these products actually acidify the soils. so that the moss wants to come back even more favorably because the lawn isn't growing well and now it's an acidic state. So people who use moss controls every year is just like turning the lawn black or turning the moss black, but not physically removing it. They're acidifying their soil every year where the moss becomes even more tenacious every year. So it becomes a really nasty cycle just using the products. So that's why we say use the product once, damage the moss as best you can, physically remove it down to the soil surface, and then you're gonna have to come back, you're gonna have to aerate, open up that soil profile. You're not gonna do an overseed this time, you're gonna have to do a reseed, probably twice the amount of seed you do for an overseed. Overseed's 4 to 5 pounds, you're probably up to 8 to 10 pounds per 1,000 square feet for a reseed, because you need to cover all those bare spots with lawn, with grass seed, and then you have to top dress, because any bare areas that have seed on them that don't have compost on top of them will dry out, you're gonna have big problems. Even though they'll germinate, it won't establish itself. So you got to protect that new seed. You got to water correctly. But if you do it right, you'll have a beat up lawn. And probably about 4 weeks later, you'll have a beautiful thick lawn again, where all that seed is taking up all those spots where the moss is at. So if it's done correctly, you should only have to do this once, maybe once every 10 years, because you're really building up the health and the thickness of your lawn. But if the moss is there all the time, comes back the next year and you try to remove it, comes back the next year, it's probably because the lawn's in the wrong place and the moss has become a dominant plant because of either acidity, all the needles that fall down from our conifers and stuff like that make the soil less conducive for lawn, but makes it really well for moss and stuff like that. Poor drainage, all those things come to light. So it might be the wrong plant in the wrong place. So again, after you do all that work, you're gonna need to mow it correctly, fertilize it. You're gonna have to water year round. You're gonna have to improve it once a year with aeration, overseed, and top dressing to keep that lawn thick and stuff like that so the moss doesn't come back. You're gonna have to lime once a year also just to make sure you keep the pH in a favorable range. Or sometimes in these areas that are giving us a bunch of problems, maybe it's a tolerance thing, right? Like throw out some shrunken heads, put in some hellebores, some sword ferns, some bleeding heart plants, stuff like that, azaleas, plants that thrive under these conditions and have a nice moss garden. And we should realize too that for every person over here that hates moss growing in their lawn, there's somebody in Asia that is screaming at grass plants growing in their beautiful moss gardens, okay? So it's this dichotomy of going on. It's just what we want is being the nice plant and what we want is we think is being invasive in our nice plantings. But there's some beautiful moss gardens around here and low maintenance, and you never have to do weeding, you never have to fertilize, you never have to water, you never have to mow. Very low maintenance, and we just let Mother Nature sometimes do what she wants to do. So again, it's part of being Zen. You can see with this guy that he was completely naked when he went out there, but any shady spots will be covered with moss if you sit out there long enough. So sometimes it's just becoming a part of nature instead of fighting against her, okay? And I'll just finish off with moles here real fast. We have two different ones. We have the Townsend and the Pacific mole, and in our soils, they can dig about 15 feet per hour in good soil, and they like good soils. And a lot of times when we're developing natural soils where we want those organisms and everything, we're gonna sometimes get moles in there because that's what they're coming in. That's their food source, is those larvas and earthworms and stuff like that, which we're developing. But they're amazing where they can actually move 32 times their own weight. So it's like a 150-pound person lifting 4,800 pounds. They are absolutely amazing. And what they do and what their job is to till our soils, is to incorporate the stuff from the top, bring it down to the bottom. So they are actually fantastic at that. Here's a couple of their habits. Spring and fall is when it's most pronounced. We're getting a lot of people calling now because moles are becoming more active. A lot of it is that they're looking for food and they're also looking for love in springtime. So they're more active. If you have soggy soils, they're gonna work higher to the surface. As the soils dry out, or maybe in our summertime, they go down lower where it's still cooler and more moist. And that's a reason why not to overwater the lawn or let it go dormant, is because the problems that they can cause with it. And they drive us crazy, right? You go out in the morning and moles come through and all these mounds in one night. You actually want to maybe just do something like this to it. I found these on the internet. These are slippers made from moles. So maybe you want to do homemade Christmas presents now and just go ahead and attract moles to your yard, and then you can get ready for next Christmas. A couple of products they have, one like these that make little noises are supposed to make it where the moles don't like it and push them away. Sometimes they work, sometimes they don't. This Mole Max is made from castor oil, supposed to make the soil taste bad. Some people say it works, some people say they think it's like adding ketchup to the soil and attracting more moles. the two things that we have found to be the most successful is coyote urine. You can actually buy coyote urine, and since it's a predator, it drives them away because it's a predator. So coyotes could be used. Hardware cloth is another product that can be used as actually the 100% way to physically not have molds in your yard is use hardware cloth. And I got like a little sample of hardware cloth, and you can get it at any hardware store. It's sold in these rolls. It's like a really heavy duty chicken wire, but smaller squares and stuff like that. You dig a trench where the molds are coming from. And sometimes you have to kind of do a little watching to see where they're moving from. A lot of times it's native areas that they move back and forth from. But you dig a trench, you make an L out of your hardware cloth, and you put it in the trench so that the L is pointing where the moles come from. They come in, they hit the hardware cloth, they think it's a rock, they try to go underneath it. When they can't do that, they just go back from where they came from because they like digging in easier soil. So if they think there's a bunch of rocks, they're not going to dig in there and stuff like that. So it's a physical barrier that if you dig this trench, put it in there, bury it, they will not get through, and you can keep the moles out of your yard 100% by using this hardware cloth, okay? Or like what I do in my yard, because that's a lot of work, is that I just rake them down, throw a little seed down, just knowing that they're just kind of Mother Nature's thing. When they have a mound like this, if you take a shovel and just try to shovel it back easily, you'll find that there's just like one little small hole there. But if you pack this soil down, you get it where like the lawn kind of dies around it and makes it even more unsightly. So a lot of it is just kind of raking and just pulling the soil away so the grass around it can still grow again, and that little hole becomes insignificant. If you're thinking though you have a big problem, you really want to get on these little guys, trapping is probably the most effective way for it, but you have to have the spirit for it. There's a great book, Russell Link's Urban Wildlife. He's a biologist for his book, Living with Wildlife in the Pacific Northwest. Really good book about moles, deer, rabbit, mountain beavers, all some critters that, especially in some of our areas that we have problems with and stuff like that, on how to combat some of those bigger critters and stuff like that. But really good information in that, okay? Last thing, rethink the lawn. Unless it's functional like this one is, where he actually is growing it as his roof, because he doesn't have area for a lawn. It's like we need to rethink some areas that we grow lawn. And to put a lawn in areas like this is a new development that's right around my house, where they put little teeny chunks of lawn. It's like you're just going to have huge problems in the future. So in some of these areas, we just need to do different things, like maybe remove it. Like this family built some vegetable beds, and now it's a garden. And then long term, we're growing vegetables and not having problems with just lawns that are in non-functional area. Okay, so the ultimate goal of natural lawn care is that you're not working on your lawn, and that it's safe for our pets, family, and the environment. So that's the talk. A lot of information. I appreciate everybody sticking around. Cameron is going to send you the links for all the other stuff. So if I went a little fast on some of these subjects, you'll be able to get more information from the fantastic websites and brochures that they make available. But I'll available for any more questions if you have it, Cameron.
Yeah, thanks so much, lad. That's always so much info there, and fit into a small amount of time. So I appreciate you showing up and appreciate the few folks that joined us today.
Yes, thank you.
There's one question that asks, can you just do normal lawn care on a mossy lawn without removing the moss?
You can. Yep. You'll probably do less mowing, less fertilizing if the lawn's kind of just, you know, like 50-50 or more than that of moss. And we, you know, for some people, you know, it's a good plant. It stays soft. It doesn't need all those regular practices and stuff like that. So as long as people are tolerant of it, I love it. Keep it.
All right. And folks, I put in a bunch of links throughout this for you to visit, but I also just threw in my contact information in case you missed anything, in case you think of something and want to follow up. Feel free to reach out with any natural yard care questions, and I can do my best to answer those or maybe hook up with Lad and get some things answered. But any other questions at this time, folks? If you know it's that time of year, you're out and about in your yards, we have the expert right here. So if there's anything that's coming up that didn't get answered today, feel free to put it in there. Give it a couple moments.
And this is the perfect time for people probably being outside, seeing how their lawn's looking, seeing maybe that some things they want to do differently and stuff. So really good timing for like, you know, the next 2 months, even into mid-June, if it's still kind of cool to do any of this kind of work on your lawn and stuff like that. So I hope everybody can take advantage of it.
Yeah, and as a reminder, on the 24th, where we have our Earth Day event, we're going to have a big old pile of free compost that you can come by and shovel up. I'm actually going to go to the place today that we get it from here in Lynnwood. It's a local supplier here, good compost, and I'm going to start shoveling compost around my yard. It's that time.
It is. It's the best thing to do. Are you getting it from that place on 212?
Yeah, Northwest Landscape Supply.
Gary does a great job over there. He has really good products. So
you guys He really does. I've gotten product from all over, and I've been really happy with his. And he's been generous enough to donate compost to our event. So he's a good community oriented guy. So
yes, he is. Yep. So
good shopping there. For
sure. Products and supporting a local company. So Gary's really good people. Really good people.
All right, folks. Well, if there's nothing else, we will give you 5 minutes back. I just got a question about where we can access the pamphlets that we're missing. I'll drop the link in the chat right now. But that's just on our website in our Natural Yard Care page. So let me just drop it. Yeah, all those pamphlets that he mentioned today and showed, they're all included on our website. There as links that you can click on and access anytime or download and save. Normally we'd be handing them out to you, but now you can access them all digitally. So again, if anything else comes up that you didn't think of today and you want to reach out, feel free to email me. There's a question, should we aerate or apply lime first?
Aerate is the number one thing, and then if you're going to put down lime or fertilizer, it's directly going in those holes. So I would recommend aeration as like first step for a lot of renovation work or trying to jumpstart some of these things. Yep. Aerate.
Yeah, and then a reminder that if you do apply lime, you want to give the 4 to 6 week window before you fertilize, right?
Yep.
And that's the same for that's the same as compost. If you lime, you don't want to compost right after, or?
Nope. I think compost will be just fine. It's usually just, you know, because we're putting down, both of those are kind of a salt. So we just don't want them to be, like I said, they kind of bind themselves up. So then they're not functioning the way we want them to and stuff. But compost away, boy, you can put the compost down anytime with any product, you know.
Good to know.
You get the results. Yep. Good one.
There's another question about this recording. We will post a link to this recording on our Natural Yard Care page for that link I just dropped. So you can find it there, but we'll also post it to the City of Lynnwood's YouTube page. It's where you can find this recording later. These are good questions.
And I get $50 per click on those recordings, right, Cameron? Is that that's the contract?
That's so right.
Click away, people. Click away. I need to retire.
Well, Lad, thank you so much, as always, for doing this. I'll be in touch via email for follow-up stuff for us. But everyone else, thank you.
I got one more talk with the City of Lynnwood about attracting bees, birds, and butterflies to yards later on this month. So check that one out too if you'd like to.
Oh, great. I totally forgot about that. That's awesome.
Part of the Natural Yard Care. So, yep. Thanks very much, everybody, for have a great, good weather. Go out and play in the